Before I begin, I just want to echo some of Dr. Fregret's thank yous. First of all, thank you to Dr. Sarah and Dr. Kemper for inviting me here to speak, and to the Center for Legislative Studies for putting on this event. But thank you especially for all of you who are here and committing this hour of time to considering constitutional issues. I often tell my students, and I'll tell all of you who I haven't had in class yet before, there's a rare opportunity in your lives that you have to spend an hour doing nothing else except considering constitutional principles. And it might not seem like a big deal right now, but that is actually a big deal. There are a few times in your life where you'll get the opportunity to do something like this. Okay, as Dr. Frederick said, I'm going to talk a little more specifically about a policy issue, in specific healthcare policy. And before I do that, let me bring you back a little bit. Today we're speaking primarily about the economy and economic issues, and certainly that has dominated the domestic agenda really ever since President Obama took the office. Even though it seems like a lifetime ago, though, 2009-2010 was not dominated necessarily by the economy, it was dominated by healthcare. Now, we spent about a year, almost an entire year, really, when President Obama became president, all the way up until March of 2010, talking about healthcare reform. And in fact, it was a fairly epic battle. It was an epic battle because it wasn't just a political battle, which it was of course that, but it was also, it was a battle that revolved around a central question, and that is, what is the proper role of government in the nation's health? That's a pretty big question. There were two answers to that, and there's still two answers to that. Some would argue in this country that your health is your responsibility, and that includes healthcare insurance. Others would argue that healthcare is a social right, just like we consider, let's say, public education or police and fire services as a social right of citizenship. That debate is ongoing, but that was really at the center of our national dialogue for about a year. And it had some pretty memorable moments, too, some good, some not good. One that really stands out, I think, to especially citizens of the Commonwealth. During this debate, the lion of the Senate, a person whose name is synonymous with healthcare reform, Ted Kennedy, passed away, all right, which initiated a special election in which Scott Brown, a Republican, won, and he ran in large part against President Obama's healthcare reform. So the irony was deep, and of course, national attention was focused on this state. We had town hall meetings during the summer that dominated the national headlines. Some turned violent. It was really an explosion of ideological differences throughout the country. President Obama gave a record number of press conferences within a given time, so much so that I remember in the lead up to his fourth press conference, primetime press conference on the issue of healthcare, two of the major networks balked and said, "We're not covering it." And that is really sort of an unprecedented move, but it shows the level at which the president was involved in this debate and at the forefront. We also saw filibusters, legislative maneuvering on both sides. Things like demon pass became common phrases throughout the country. And so it was quite an epic battle. But in the end, March 23rd, 2010, President Obama signed into law what the New York Times called the most expansive social legislation in decades. Right? Signed into law the nation's new healthcare system. And I think the New York Times is accurate, by the way. It is a fairly significant change. Really, you'd have to go back 50 years to the creation of Medicare and Medicaid since we've had such a major change in the nation's healthcare system. Right? So, what does it do? Well, just some basic background. It's a very complex law, all right, several thousand pages long. But the gist of it is this. It expands healthcare insurance to approximately 30 million individuals once it's fully implemented, which will take till 2014. Once it's fully implemented, though, it'll cover about 30 million who are currently uninsured out of about 50. So it's not universal healthcare insurance, but it's certainly a big step in that direction. Well, how does it do that? How does it just cover 30 million people? Well, basically two mechanisms. The first is an individual mandate. Now here in Massachusetts, we know what an individual mandate is, right? We've had this in place since 2005. All right, but an individual mandate basically is an obligation that you as an individual have to own healthcare insurance or else face a penalty. The other way that it was fairly dramatically expanded is that there was a provision, and there is a provision within the law, that requires states to dramatically expand their Medicaid programs. Okay, what is Medicaid? Basically, Medicaid is the government's health insurance plan for low-income and disabled Americans. What's important about that, and what I'll speak to in terms of constitutional terms, is that it's paid for 50-50, 50 by the state, 50 by the national government, okay? And the expansion is, in essence, forced upon the states. All right, we'll talk about the nuances of that in a minute. All right, and then lastly, so the individual mandate, expansion of Medicaid, and then finally, and this is a less controversial aspect, fairly strict regulations were put on health insurers to say that health insurers can no longer not cover someone because they have a pre-existing condition, for instance. They can't put lifetime caps on how much they pay out for your health and so on. Now, if, you know, let's say, for instance, the debate just ended there, March 23rd, 2010. That still would be, I would argue, a defining generational moment. I mean, we've really changed substantially, not only the way we approach healthcare, but the way we approach government's role within healthcare. So a major achievement regardless. But of course, the story's not over, or else I wouldn't be talking to you about healthcare today. The story continues, and that is because two of the major provisions that I just mentioned are being challenged on constitutional terms. The individual mandate and the requirement that states expand their Medicaid programs. So let me give you a brief history. Since March 23rd, 2010, and in fact, the very same day, on March 23rd, 13 states filed suit against the federal government. Leading the way was Virginia, who preempted the national law by passing a law that says, no law shall compel our citizens to buy health insurance. Of course, they saw what was coming, they passed a law to preempt it, and then on the same day that it was passed into law, they filed legislation in federal court saying that it was unconstitutional. Okay, 13 states joined in, and on that day, an attorney who was representing the state said this: we are convinced that this legislation is fundamentally flawed as a matter of constitutional law. It exceeds, that it exceeds the scope of proper constitutional authority of the federal government and tramples, in strong language, tramples upon the rights and prerogatives of states and their citizens. That's a fairly strong statement. Okay, after that suit was filed, another 14 states joined in to total 28 states. Now do the math. 28 states out of 50, that's more than half of the American states are now suing the federal government on constitutional terms with regard to its healthcare law. That's a big deal, okay? No matter what side of the debate you land on, that's a big deal. Now, arguments in terms of the individual mandate, and I'll move through this quickly. Arguments that it's constitutional, all right, that it is within the national government's authority to impose a national, to impose an individual mandate. Number one, the Commerce Clause, all right, as you all know, you should know if you've gone through American government at some point during your time here, that the national government has the authority to regulate interstate commerce. So the argument goes, the Congress can regulate any activity that has, quote, a cumulative economic effect on the states, a cumulative economic effect. I think few people would argue that healthcare has a cumulative economic effect. Right, it's a $2 trillion a year industry, much of which crosses state lines. So that's argument one. Commerce Clause gives the national government this authority. Argument two, Congress has the power to tax. Well, the individual mandate is basically a tax, right? It requires you to buy health insurance or else you are levied a financial tax. We tax for things like Social Security, Medicare, things very similar to healthcare, right? Medicare is healthcare for those 65 and older. Social Security is a social insurance system. And no one really seems to have a major problem with that. And so what's the difference? Number three, the Necessary and Proper Clause. This is a little more nuanced, but it says, the argument in favor of constitutionality says, let's say the individual mandate is in fact unconstitutional in isolation. Okay, if we just pose an individual mandate, let's argue that that in itself would be unconstitutional. The argument as far as the Necessary and Proper Clause is this: it is necessary and proper for the whole package of healthcare reform, which is constitutional because that whole package regulates commercial activity. The whole package regulates commercial activity, and it's necessary, it's a necessary component of this package for it to work. Right, the individual mandate is a linchpin of this package. Without the individual mandate, the plan doesn't work. And so it's necessary for the plan to work, and it's also proper because, well, the package itself regulates interstate commerce. That's a fairly strong argument. Arguments 1, 2, 3 in favor of constitutionality. All right, well, what are the arguments against? There are three there as well, each of them countering the points that I just made. Number one, the Commerce Clause. Those against the constitutionality of the individual mandate say this. The Commerce Clause does not apply to inactivity, in that this would be an unprecedented move on the part of the federal government to impose a tax or a fine on doing nothing. Right? It's one thing to say that if you're engaging in commercial activity, you can be regulated. It's another thing to say, well, you're doing nothing, but you can still be regulated. And so that's a major difference in terms of anything that's been regulated in the past. Number two, the argument is that the individual mandate is not a tax at all. I mean, what's a tax? A tax is when you consume goods, a tax is on your income. Can you be taxed for doing nothing? Can you be taxed for not engaging in commercial activity? I heard a pithy comment the other day when I was watching one of those cable news shows, which is, I try to steer away from those, but I was watching one nonetheless, sort of an indulgence. And as I was watching, someone made the argument to say, okay, well, if we allow this, let's say the federal government determines that I'm overweight and requires that I go to the gym. Can I be fined for not going to the gym? Can I be fined, in essence, for sitting on my couch and doing nothing? It does impact the healthcare system, you could argue. And number three, the Necessary and Proper Clause, they say, well, it's not necessary or proper because, number one, there are other ways to achieve universal healthcare other than the individual mandate. So the argument is not necessary. You could do other things that wouldn't violate the Constitution. And number two, it's not proper because, some argue, that it violates the 10th Amendment, which allows the states to regulate their own economic activity. Some basic court history. This has been through the courts. This isn't just an academic exercise. The first court to hear it says that this is it's not inactivity at all. In fact, by choosing to forgo insurance, that is an economic activity because the first federal court judge argued everyone at some point in their lives accesses health care. And so in other words, if you choose not to buy health insurance, that in itself is an action because you are choosing to instead pay it down the line. And so the first judge who heard this case said, of course it's constitutional. All right, but it didn't end there. In December 2010, a Virginia court hearing the Virginia's case said that this is an unprecedented expansion of federal power and cannot be justified, struck it down. 1 month later, another federal court judge went even further in Florida, and he said that not only is the individual mandate unconstitutional, since it's a linchpin of the entire plan, the whole thing needs to be thrown out. That's a very significant decision. That's not just tossing out the individual mandate, that's tossing out the whole law. Another court in Atlanta heard this case recently, in fact, in August 2011. 2-1, unconstitutional. One of the justices, a Democrat, appointed by President Clinton, making many in the administration nervous. Right, 2011, September, this month, a win for the administration. The Virginia court heard an appeal and overturned the initial decision. Okay, so it's been a back and forth, back and forth. And it's roughly even in terms of court decisions. And finally, if you were reading the headlines just a day or two ago, there's speculation now to say that the administration is no longer going to appeal at the appellate level. In fact, they're going to fast track it to the Supreme Court. If that happens, most likely the Supreme Court will hear the constitutionality of this law by summer. And that's kind of where we're at as far as the individual mandate. Let me just briefly mention the other aspect that is so controversial, and then I'll open it up to any questions. The other aspect that is controversial, although less so, is the requirement that states expand their Medicaid program. The argument that it's constitutional is that the Medicaid program is voluntary. Any state in this country can opt out of the Medicaid program anytime they want. Right? It's completely voluntary. The reason all 50 states do it is because they get 50 cents for every dollar. Right? So they'd be crazy not to. Right, but it's technically voluntary, and so if the national government says you need to expand your existing Medicaid program, and state says, well, we don't want to, the national government can simply say, close the program. All right, we're not compelling you to do anything. Now, the arguments that it's not constitutional is that this isn't necessarily voluntary anymore. This is an institution that now millions of people rely on, and the states rely on their revenue. And so it's not persuasion necessarily, which is protected by the Constitution. Instead, some argue that it amounts to coercion, right? And that states have little choice but to follow the law because they're financially compelled to do so. And so I'll leave you with this. I don't have any answers for you. All right. None of us in here, or at least very few of us in here, would count themselves as constitutional scholars. I certainly wouldn't. But I do know what I believe, and I know that you do too. And so my question to you all is, what do you think about this debate? I mean, this is a debate that is really going to, I think, define not only the legal system, but also our generation. And so what do you think? Where do you stand? Is this law constitutional? Is it not constitutional? I'm very interested to hear your ideas. Okay, thank you.